We have 94 days to go before Brexit. You know already about Grant Thornton. This is just a few facts and figures about our international reach. The point of speaking to you today is partly to showcase that there are solutions and ways to alleviate the issues that people foresee, to set yourself up best for trading as near as possible as though Brexit had not happened, still being able to access your customer base. I'm just going to turn off my video to stop my internet dropping out, as it's been doing that this morning. So we've got me, I'm Dan, I'm a VAT advisor in the UK. We've got Yvonne from the UK as well, talking about direct tax a little bit later on, and two counterparts in our other Grant Thornton member firms in our international network, Marion, both in our previous firm, and Robert Jan from the Netherlands, who is also highly experienced and we work with very closely. So we're going to start the recording now, and by staying on, you consent to that recording. Thank you. There are 94 days to go before the end of the transition period, after which point the UK will no longer be able to behave as though it is a member state of the EU. For the last 9 months or so, we have been still enjoying all of the trading advantages that the EU membership gives us. But that is going to stop on 1st of January. And whilst the EU and the UK are still debating exactly how that is going to work, it is becoming increasingly certain that it's important to plan. If Brexit has taught us one thing, it's that failing to plan can be quite disastrous. And even though everything is not set in stone as to how it's going to work, there are definitely steps that you can take now to put yourself in the best possible position to trade after the transition period ends. This map we're just starting on, apologies to the island of Ireland here, which we haven't quite got the map right, but time's not allowed to get that right. It does appear correctly on a later slide. And we're fully aware, of course, that Ireland remains a member state of the EU. So Brexit is going to affect most clearly goods trades more so than services. There are going to be some services impacts, but those are relatively less important than the goods, and that's why the audience that we've invited today has some degree of involvement with goods trading with the EU. What's going to happen with effect from 1st of January 2021 is that the situation we've all been used to for a long time, which works very well, free movement of goods between the member states where there are not border checks. So we've been used to dispatching when goods go between member states and acquiring when you receive those goods into your member state. That is all going to change, and there's going to be complication with customs declarations being necessary. So at the moment, you are used to similar rules for exporting and dispatching, and similar rules for importing and acquiring. But when you're dispatching and acquiring within the EU, it's much, much easier. There are few, if any, checks on the goods. If you are importing, you have to deal with the frontier processes and the import declaration. If you're exporting, you have to deal with that. So the people for whom this is most of an issue are those who dealt exclusively with the EU and have never to date been importing or exporting goods from outside the EU or to outside the EU. So what is going to happen on 1st of January 2021? I think of this much as a curtain. A curtain is going to come down, which is going to make the frontier processes more complicated, so that between certainly GB, and by GB I'm talking about Scotland, England and Wales, there will be customs processes to deal with the movement of goods across the border into, here we're talking about mainland Europe, not the island of Ireland. So there are going to be export declarations to fill out, and there'll be import declarations to be dealt with. And for a lot of clients that are contacting us now, we are seeing that they need to make themselves as competitive as their rivals who are already in the EU 27 member states that remain after Brexit. So a lot of clients are thinking about setting themselves up in member states that remain member states in order that they can continue trading their goods hassle-free without these border complications. For starters, looking just at this diagram, you've got exports still zero rated to the EU, but much more complication with paperwork that has to be filled out and the routes that need to be considered. This, of course, is wider than just VAT and duties. For example, if you're exporting livestock, there are only certain ports that will deal with that sort of export. And of course, the big question is customs duties. The point of duties has always been to protect home producers. And when the UK is no longer part of that home, part of that club, which is the EU, there will be producers in the EU that duties will protect. At the moment, we have a sketch of what we think those duties are going to be coming into the UK. The government has published that, and that's available to check what the duty should be if you're bringing goods in from outside the UK. And the EU tariff is as it ever was. In the absence of a trade deal, that is what we expect to happen. And lots of people are holding out hope for a trade deal. Of course, a trade deal does not mean that all of the complication goes away. In fact, potentially quite the opposite. A trade deal can mean more complication, in that if a particular deal is agreed for goods from certain countries, then there will be complication of having to detect where those goods are from. So things that the UK has never had to worry about before when trading with Europe, such as Incoterms and customs classification, become very important. The three parts of customs that we think about are valuation, origin, and classification. And none of those aspects have been had to be thought about when trading with the EU, because it only really applies to imports and exports. But all of those acquisitions and dispatches become exports and imports. The UK is a third country to Europe. So what other things can we be thinking of beyond the relatively simple aspects of customs declarations, that additional complication? There are other dimensions to consider, such as export licensing. Do you have goods which previously moved freely and now need to be subject to export controls? Is there potential military dual use of goods? The Five Eyes, the intelligence community of UK, USA, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, persists and is not affected by the UK's exit from the EU. However, movements of goods which are controlled does become more important. Those goods have always flowed between the UK and mainland Europe without very much interest from the Five Eyes community before, but that will now be under greater scrutiny. Incoterms. Incoterms amongst European trainers never really been an issue because it's been so easy to move goods across European borders. But suddenly, the Incoterms which you're trading under, and Incoterms are internationally recognised terms of trade, determining who is the consignee and who is responsible for the frontier processes and the payment of tax and duty, suddenly become much more important. So one of the things which our clients are finding at the moment is that they may inadvertently have agreed to Incoterms such as DDP, delivered duty paid, in their contracts. Not an issue in terms of trading with Europe up until the end of the transition period. But suddenly, contract terms such as DDP could place a business having to register for VAT and customs processes in member states to which it exports, simply because the contract says that, or indeed to remain competitive against its mainland Europe rivals. Julia, may we move on to the next slide, please? So I promised you a short look at Northern Ireland because we're going to have a rather complicated situation in Northern Ireland. All is not yet set in stone for Northern Ireland, but what we do know, I will try and describe to you as simply as possible, and that is that we will have potentially three different sets of rules. We'll have Great Britain rules for goods, Great Britain again meaning Scotland, Wales and England. We'll have Northern Ireland rules for goods, and we'll have UK rules for services covering all four countries of the Union, Northern Ireland, Scotland, England and Wales. So if you're operating in or with Northern Ireland, there's potentially three different regimes to contend with. Northern Ireland is put in this rather odd position of being both inside and outside the EU for VAT and customs purposes. Essentially, all of the island of Ireland, the physical island of Ireland, remains in the EU single market for goods, with a customs border somewhere in the Irish Sea. And Northern Ireland remains part of the UK's custom territory, but also imposes EU customs duties in some cases. So we don't know the practical details of how duties on goods from GB, travelling from Great Britain to Northern Ireland, will be collected or indeed refunded, because Northern Ireland still remains part of the UK, the single market of the UK. So there should not be any duties ultimately payable on goods which remain within Northern Ireland. The EU has very fixed ideas on exactly how this is going to work, the UK less so, and it is being debated. If you are affected by this, I suggest looking at it a little bit later on, because time does not permit within this webinar to go into it in greater detail. Suffice to say, it's going to be complicated. Next slide, please. So there is going to be a little bit of trading, more than a little bit, between Northern Ireland and Republic of Ireland, which is going to be essentially within the EU for trading purposes. So if goods stay in Northern Ireland, we think they're going to be consumed in Northern Ireland, and there should not be any movement into Europe of them. But lots of people have quizzed whether this is going to be a backdoor into the single market of the EU, and checks on a border. Everybody is clearly very against having a physical border with checks. Next slide, please. Services, we've had a useful simplification called MOS, the mini one-stop shop. So for electronically supplied services, where providers actually find themselves subject to VAT in several member states where a customer belongs, that has enabled businesses not to have to register in all of those member states, but simply to account for it through one member state, which actually gets almost a commission, a kickback for administering that. If you are enrolled in the MOS, that membership, if you are headquartered in the UK, is going to cease as of 1st of January, and you will have to continue accounting for that correctly. You'll have to identify with a member state and sign up for a non-union MOS, not being a member of the European Union, with that member state. There is going to be an OS, however, which is a one-stop shop for a wider variety of services. That OS is not going to be operational until the 1st of July 2021, but that should be a convenience for lots more services where you are subject to a EU place of supply, which obliges you to register for VAT in another member state. The OS should enable you to account for that simply through registering for the OS in one member state rather than registering for VAT all over. The biggest complication, I think, will come if you are dealing with both goods and services. So, for example, a business which wraps up the cost of its goods in its services, maybe a maintenance business that keeps buildings functional and secure, that type of business will have both goods movements across frontiers and provide services. So it's potentially within two different VAT treatments for a single invoice with a few supplies on that. That is going to be a complication to work through, where before it has not been such an issue for Europe. But we're not going to major on services today, because it is generally less disturbed by the end of the transition period than the goods trades are. Next slide, please. So customs considerations that I've mentioned are going to be suddenly front of mind, where they've never had to be before in dealing with Europe. A few things that a lot of clients are thinking about: there are various customs authorizations, particularly people talk about putting goods under bond, a customs warehousing regime where you can trade without bringing goods into free circulation. This is something which could be a good option in the longer term, but the window is closing rapidly on getting that ready for 1st of January, because in order to get a customs warehouse, any authorisation for any customs process agreed with HMRC, you do need to have a comprehensive customs guarantee, and there are waiting times for all of those. Other customs procedures I was going to mention, IPR or IP, inward processing relief, allows you to bring goods in for processing from outside the UK, adapt them or change them, and then re-export them without having had to bring them in to the UK through the customs border. Double duty dilemma, I mentioned this because there will be several businesses that have stock holding in the UK, which has already been brought in from outside the UK and paid appropriate duties on those imports. If those are destined for mainland Europe, but they haven't moved before the 1st of January 2021, there's potentially a double duty or a second section of duties to pay on those when you do move them into the EU, because this curtain that I've mentioned descending this border is then going to turn those goods not cleared for free circulation in the EU. They are at the moment, because the UK is still behaving as an EU member state, but they won't be from 1st of January. So many more frontier processes to get used to. What businesses are doing is either upskilling themselves to be able to do this, but people with those customs skills are increasingly thin on the ground. So what businesses are also doing is cooperating with freight agents who already have that expertise to contract out that complication, to remove the headache to somebody else. And please don't forget, up until 30th of June 2021, there is still, or until the funding runs out, there is still customs grants available for recruitment of suitable staff, training those staff, and upgrading your IT systems to be compliant with the new customs requirements. And of course, if you do apply for one of those grants, we'd be very happy to provide sufficient training to make use of that. Next slide, please. VAT, we've covered at the outset, a few of things that are going to change. Import VAT deferral, those of you who are used to acquisition VAT accounting, essentially import VAT is going to become rather simpler and quicker for cash flow. Instead of paying it at the border and having to reclaim it based on your C79 certificates, that is all going to flow through the VAT return. So it'll be immediately in and out, reclaiming to the extent you're able to, if you're fully taxable, through the VAT return. That's a welcome change, something that should actually be simpler as a result of the end of the transition period. Acquisition and dispatch accounting, especially still an issue if you are trading in Northern Ireland, because you're still going to need to keep track of that. Lots of people have thought, yippee, easy sales list and interest tax declarations will go with full Brexit and the end of the transition period. Unfortunately, not for interest tax declarations. EC sales lists will finish. So I think your final EC sales list, if you are UK headquartered, will be delivered in shortly after the end of December. But interest tax declarations must continue. That information will still continue to be mandatory. And there may be changes to the VAT return as a result of that, changes to the boxes. The EU quick fixes, very briefly, I'll mention this because at the moment, during this transitional period, trading with the EU is actually even easier than it has been before. There's four quick fixes. One of them is the call-off stock simplification, and that currently enables stock to be held in another EU member state destined for a customer, and it can be there for up to a year before the customer calls it off without the supplier needing to be registered in that member state. That's very handy at the moment. That disappears with the end of the transition period, as does triangulation, if anyone uses that. It's all going to be slightly more complex, and you need to find ways to make it work as best you can. So next slide, please. The point of today, as I've said, it isn't to take you through everything we know about Brexit, because you will have heard that ad infinitum and there are many sources for it. It's more to demonstrate there are things that you can do to make this better and to enable yourself to trade as competitively as possible after the transition period. We've had a very close cooperation with Grant Thornton's Netherlands firm for one of our clients that imports a lot of goods into the EU and is headquartered in the UK. And that business had already begun motions to get itself set up in the Netherlands to still be in the EU for purposes of trading in the EU. And for that business, we've gone through a process of analysing what are the options for them before and after the end of the transition period to best set them up to be able to trade compliantly and competitively after the end of the transition period. And they are now tending towards keeping the subsidiary, which they'd already begun in the Netherlands, open just for employing some salespeople. And they will, alongside that, have a non-established VAT registration for their main business in order that they can take advantage of everything that being in the EU for VAT and customs purposes means. And they may very well do that in conjunction with a fiscal representative in order to make full use of their VAT registration in the Netherlands. And that, we hope, will equip them to trade as competitively as possible. Robert Jan, you in the Netherlands and your colleagues have helped us extremely with that. So I'd like to introduce Robert Jan to speak to you a little bit about the VAT and customs regime in the Netherlands and how that may help your business after end of the transition period. Robert Jan, over to you.
Yes. Well, thank you, Dan, for this introduction. Yeah, this case study one was a great example of our cooperation between our member offices, of course. In which we are glad to assist this client to research and review the various possibilities. You can think about, for example, it was already a non-established, this UK established company. Are they going to do business as a non-established company still in the Netherlands? Are they going to use the incorporated Dutch entity for their business? Are they planning to set up a branch? You can even use a sort of hybrid structure where you can use both situations. So use the non-established entity, the UK entity, as well as the Dutch entity for their business. And all those kind of options have a different outcome, of course, for VAT and customs. And what we did was we looked into all these scenarios, explained the VAT customs, but as well as the transfer pricing and corporate income tax outcome and results of these in these various scenarios, and proposed the best scenario for the client, also taking into account their own wishes, of course, what they want to desire in respect of additional administrative obligations. Yeah, and in that respect, using the Netherlands is a great opportunity to enter the European mainland, the European Union market, as of the 1st of January 2021, because it's rather easy to do business in the Netherlands. So you can think about, for example, by incorporating a Dutch entity in the Netherlands, which is rather easy to do. You don't have to set up a large capital requirement, even providing an initial capital of one euro cent or 1 euro should be is sufficient to incorporate a Dutch established BV. Yeah, you need a notary, of course. We work a lot with different notaries to incorporate those entities. And it's also rather quickly incorporated. It's only taking a few weeks to have it set up. And a great positive aspect of having a Dutch entity, a Dutch-based company, is if you're going to import products into the Netherlands, let's say from the UK. It's going to qualify as an importation of goods, which Daniel also explained. And usually you have to pay, of course, import VAT upon the moment of importation. That would result that you have to prepay a lot of import VAT, especially the the amounts in place are rather significant. And you have to pre-finance that VAT. So that can be a disadvantage, of course, for your cash flow. And what the Netherlands already had for a rather long time is that we had the opportunity to request and obtain an import VAT deferment license, meaning that once you have the license, Dutch customs will no longer levy any import VAT upon importation of the products into the Netherlands. And you can simply, or you simply have to report the payable import VAT in your VAT return, in which you can reclaim the same import VAT as well, of course, as long as the company has a full, complete right to reclaim any import VAT. And that is a big advantage, because you can expect that if you have to pay import VAT upon importation, let's say in the 3rd of January, and the first return for that period is the first quarter return in the Netherlands, which has to be filed at the end of April, and then you can reclaim that VAT, then it can take around 4 or 5 months before you can get that VAT back. That's why many companies use such an import VAT deferment license to ease the burden of the import VAT and increase the cash flow position. If you incorporate a Dutch entity, you don't have to appoint a fiscal representative. Instead of, let's say, a UK business who can also register as a non-established entity in the Netherlands. So there is no requirement to appoint a fiscal representative solely in order to be registered as a UK business in the Netherlands as a non-established entity. You can simply do that, and you can do business from the Netherlands. However, like with the import VAT deferment license, this has a certain incentive if you appoint a fiscal representative, like making use of VAT entrepôts, so make use of a zero rate in using those VAT entrepôts, but as well as the import VAT deferment license. And if you're a non-Dutch established business, you can still have such an import VAT deferment license, but then you have the requirement to appoint a fiscal representative in the Netherlands. It can be a limited or a general fiscal representative. But that means that you also have to request a license to appoint a fiscal representative, as well as remit a sort of guarantee amount to the Dutch tax authorities in order to get that license, because a fiscal representative can be held liable for the VAT, which is not paid or has to be paid. And that's why the Dutch tax authorities want to have a guarantee amount. And that guarantee amount is still rather reasonable. A couple of years ago, they reduced it. It's now a minimum of 5,000 euros and it can go up to around 100,000 euros, which is the maximum. And you can get it back after the fiscal representation ended and the period to recover the VAT of 5 years has been passed. Next slide, please. From a Dutch perspective, the Netherlands is really a great hub for doing business in the European mainland. We have outstanding logistic facilities with one of the biggest harbors, of course, in the world in Rotterdam. And logistics is in our blood. So we have a lot of freight forwarders, which can help with your customs burden, your customs compliance in the Netherlands. They can even act as a limited fiscal representative. We have a great, I must say, as a tax advisor, we have still a great tax authority to deal with. They are most of the time very cooperative and approachable. No really strict lines or between the tax authorities and the business. So that's great to see. And another great opportunity for the Netherlands is that we have a quarterly VAT filing obligation. So you only have to report 4 quarterly returns a year, no annual returns. So that means that the compliance costs are rather low instead of filing monthly returns. Of course, it is still possible to file monthly returns, especially for companies which have a significant refund position, of course, and they want to get the VAT back a little bit sooner. Some companies choose to do a voluntary monthly reporting obligation. And of course, it is possible in the Netherlands to get your VAT refunds immediately. So there is no tax account system or carry forward system. If a VAT return results in a receivable VAT amount, you will get that VAT amount around 3-4 weeks after the return has been filed, and no further questions are raised by the Dutch tax authority. So that runs rather smoothly, especially now in the current COVID pandemic. Of course, they issue those kind of refunds even more quickly due to the businesses having the requirement to need that cash in that respect. A great thing to add as well is it's a little bit already longer in the European Union that you need to have a European-based business in order to export products from the European Union. And the same will also apply from the Netherlands as of the 1st of October 2020. So that's in a few days. That means that if you are going to export any products from the Netherlands or any other European member state, you have to arrange the exportation by an EU-based company. So if you have a UK business registered as a non-established business for VAT purposes in the Netherlands, that company cannot export products from the Netherlands. And there are all kind of possibilities to avoid, of course, by incorporating again a Dutch BV or use a freight forwarder to perform this exportation on the company's behalf. And a few days ago, the Dutch tax authority informed us that Dutch customs will not enforce any penalties, at least until the 1st of January 2021. So until that day, it's still possible for non-EU businesses, non-EU established businesses to export products from the Netherlands. Yes. Next slide, please.
Thank you very much, Robert Jan, for bringing out some of those nuances of trading within the Netherlands. And it's fair to say that you still have a very quick turnaround time to obtain VAT registrations from the authority, isn't it? That's still relatively swift.
Yeah, no, VAT registration takes around 2 weeks. They say that after the request, they should issue an VAT number in 5 working days. We noticed that it's getting a little bit longer, but it's still rather swift to do. It's a rather easy process to do as well. Yeah.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. So that's an illustration of our international reach and our cooperation between UK and Netherlands. Our next mini case study is more something which is actually prompted by coronavirus difficulty and a change in the use of technology, but for a business which has long been concerned about the effect that Brexit will have on it. And it's almost used that issue as a dry run for how to get set up to trade using technology sensibly. So the Netherlands case study was to try to make it as though Brexit had never happened and carry on as normal. This case study is more to use the situation to your advantage in order to be able to carry on doing what you did in a new way using technology. And Marion will tell you more about this exercise, but we ended up with the client registering for VAT in Ireland in order to take full advantage of that. So over to Marion from Grant Thornton Ireland for a run through that, please. Over to you, Marion.
Thanks very much, Dan. Good morning, everybody, from a sunny Dublin. And yes, the project we worked on with Dan there that he mentioned related to goods that normally leave Ireland to be sold in the UK by way of auction. And because of the COVID-19 restrictions, it wasn't possible for the goods to leave here. So the client is looking at doing an online auction. So Dan and Julia contacted me just to talk through what the Irish VAT implications might be. And we succeeded quite quickly in securing an Irish VAT registration. And one of the benefits of the VAT registration was that the client was able to actually recover Irish VAT, which would normally recover via an EVR claim, via its Irish VAT return. So I suppose that was a good result all around. And as Dan says, it's now in place for the 1st of January. So the client can continue to operate here in that kind of manner in the future. So the first slide there, please, Julia, if you don't mind. That's great, thank you. I'll take you through, just run through us what the Irish VAT compliance situation, how it works here in Ireland, and also then as to what scenarios we're looking at in terms of UK business coming to us to discuss what they might do or look to do prior to the 1st of January so that they can operate here come Brexit. So just like the Netherlands, UK established businesses can operate an Irish VAT registration here without having a fiscal representative. Irish VAT compliance, it's reasonably straightforward. There are six bi-monthly VAT returns and one annual return of trading details. The VAT returns, I think, are one of the maybe most straightforward ones in the EU to complete, and that you just maybe have a number of six to eight boxes to complete. And some of those boxes relate to intra-EU trading, goods and services. And then there's one annual return of trading details at year end, which details all of the purchases and sales made at various different rates. With effect from the 1st of January, we are introducing proposed postponed accounting for import VAT to alleviate the import VAT cost that will arise on importing goods from the UK come the 1st of January. And that's being introduced for all traders for an initial period. Once that initial period has expired, and I don't know the length of it at this stage because legislation hasn't been published, it would be at the discretion of the Irish Revenue as to whether or not the postponed accounting will apply for each individual trader. Maybe a point to make in terms of, let's say, UK business looking for an Irish VAT registration to import goods into Ireland come the 1st of January. That importer will also require an Irish EORI number at that point. Just to make sure that that's done, it's a fairly straightforward process once the Irish VAT registration is put in place. And then maybe just to touch on the points that Dan has made in terms of the customs duty implications of importing into Ireland on the 1st of January as to what rates might apply. And the guidance being given at the moment is that if we're looking at maybe hopefully a free trade agreement, we're looking at maybe Canada and what rates might apply on the import of goods from Canada at the moment. And if not, you look at World Trade Organization tariffs and you're looking at what might happen on importations from China. So that's the general guidance being given here at the moment. And I like the picture of the ship. There's some suggestion here that we might look at putting in place ferries operating from, let's say, Rosslare to mainland Europe so that we don't have to use the UK as a land bridge and just get the goods moved from mainland Europe to Ireland without going through any of the customs formalities and ship or transporting through the UK. So let's see what happens in that space, but that's something that's been considered here at the moment. So Julia, if you go on to the next slide. And this really slide is a summary of what we've been looking at the moment or in the last maybe 6 months as to what's triggering the UK businesses looking to seek Irish VAT registrations. And again, back to a point that Dan was making in terms of triangulation, the simplification will no longer apply come the 1st of January where you're using a UK VAT number to sell goods here, where the goods are being maybe shipped directly, let's say, from France to Ireland. So in that scenario, the UK business would look at putting in place an Irish VAT registration so it can account for Irish VAT on intra-community acquisition here and make the onward sale to the Irish customer. Again, something similar will apply to the call-off stock provisions, which will no longer apply again come the 1st of January in terms of goods maybe moving from the UK to Ireland. So again, an Irish VAT registration will be required if the UK business is going to be the importer. And that then the UK business will then account for Irish domestic VAT on the sale to the Irish customer. And this is one again that Dan's taken all my best lines, where we're looking at a vendor based in the UK has agreed to sell DDP to Irish customers. And this has arisen in terms of the large multiples operating here with their contracts. They would insist on putting in DDP, delivery duty paid, into those contracts. Up until now, it hasn't mattered that this has been the case because there's been no duty to be paid anyway on the bringing of the goods into Ireland. But again, come the 1st of January, that's all going to change. So if any of your contracts contain this delivery duty paid Incoterm, you need to look at your Irish VAT registration requirements and as well as that, what what customs duty might apply on the importation into Ireland. And maybe one other thing we're looking at in terms of US businesses who actually have, let's say, UK subsidiaries making sales into the EU. We're now looking at those businesses being headquartered in the US, looking at Ireland. We're looking at one particular instance where the business sells services to consumers within the EU, and it is now looking to, it has now set up an Irish subsidiary to sell in future into the EU because of Brexit. And maybe then there's a certain flurry of activity here at the moment, again, in terms of non-union MOS registrations, because again, as Dan has said, would affect from the 1st of January. The UK businesses will not be able to use MOS. And we're looking at putting in place non-union MOS registrations in Ireland so that UK businesses can continue to account for local domestic VAT wherever their customers are located throughout the EU. So happy to talk about any of those particular scenarios at a later stage. And I think that's the end of my presentation. I'm handing over to Yvonne to talk about the direct tax implications in the UK of any of those scenarios for UK businesses. So over to you, Yvonne.
Thanks, Marion. I'm just going to say hello, then I'm going to switch my camera off because I've been having connectivity problems today. So thanks, everybody, for joining. Slight change in direction now in terms of what I'm going to speak about, just for a few minutes. I'm conscious of time and the need to keep some time for questions. So I'll try and keep this as punchy and as brief as possible. But corporate and international tax and direct tax quite often gets lost in the crush a little bit when we're talking about Brexit and the implications there. So just a few highlights. Judith, if you can pop onto the next slide, please. So just a few things to think about here in terms of the UK direct tax position. So, you know, worth bearing in mind, the key thing from a direct tax point of view is that the UK regime hasn't changed during the transition period. So everything that applied prior to entering into the transition period is unchanged and will stay that way until the end of that transition period. So EU tax directives that you may be taking advantage of continue to apply until the end of that transition period. So groups with UK companies, you can continue to take advantage of nil withholding tax rates included in the parent subsidiary and interest and royalties directive and other directives such as the EU mergers directive, which isn't possibly quite so widely used. At the end of the transition period, though, those directives will not apply to the UK. There have been some concessions announced already that from a UK perspective, we intend to continue to apply the provisions of the directives on outbound payments. So if we're making interest payments to member states, UK withholding tax, which would otherwise be 20%, wouldn't apply. We don't apply withholding tax on dividends outbound anyway. So that's positive on the outbound side, but obviously from in the opposite direction, that won't necessarily apply. So that sort of really covers the right hand side of that wheel. EU state aid, that's really it. So just to look out for points of dialogue, it could actually be good news from a UK perspective. To the extent that we would be less restricted by the EU. For example, the R&D regime had to be rewritten in order to be more compliant from a state aid point of view. Whether those sorts of things have to be done going forward remains to be seen. And then just a quick nod really to ATAD and DAC 6. The ATAD measures, for those of you familiar with those, they are anti-tax avoidance directives, which were introduced as a result of the OECD's base erosion and profit shifting initiatives that have been around for a number of years. So the UK as an EU member state has been bound to comply with those ATAD measures. The vast majority, we've tended to be a front footer on most of those, and the UK have already implemented a great deal of measures in order to be compliant and consistent with the EU. They are in domestic law now, and there's no suggestion that they will change. So those measures already implemented are expected to stay in order to, you know, sort of remain a sort of fully paid up member of Europe per se, and competitive in that respect. DAC 6 falls into a similar sort of category, really. Those of you familiar with that, that's a reporting obligation in terms of cross-border EU cross-border transactions. Although the reporting is delayed due to COVID-19, the law has been implemented from a domestic point of view in the UK. Next slide, please, Julia. So just rattling through that. So I've mentioned about the directives. Worth flagging, though, that from 31st of January 2020, in legal terms, we've not been an EU member state. So although the directives apply, there may be other references in the EU 27 as countries that refer to being a member of the EU, and to the extent that we're reliant upon those, we may need to make some changes. So just a nod to that. So tax consolidation regimes or CFC regimes, or if you've taken advantage of an EU migration piece of planning, if the other country is referring to the EU, it's worth bearing in mind that, and you may need to make some structural changes. End of transition, I've already referred to this. We won't be benefiting from those directives unless there's a specific concession being made by the other member states. So Italy's already on the front foot in terms of naming the UK rather than an EU member state in some of their domestic law. Where the directives don't apply, what companies are going to need to do is consider whether a double taxation treaty is applicable, and look to that treaty network in order to reduce any withholding taxes. So that introduces an admin requirement. You'll need to get that in place before the end of the year. You're going to start making remittances without withholding taxes. Next slide, please, Julia. So just to sort of wrap up, I'm getting a network quality message, apologies. So do be mindful around other domestic law or treaties referring to an EU member state. The US treaties are relevant here. So if, say, for instance, you've got UK at the top of a structure and you've got a EU member in the middle and at the bottom, you can, historically, you would no doubt have been able to remit monies to that EU member state in the middle, to the extent that UK was a member state at the top and that had got a more beneficial arrangement under a treaty than, say, the middle company. You won't be able to do that anymore once the UK is outside of the EU. And Dan and Marion and Robert Jan have been talking about potential changes to your supply chain. To the extent your supply chain is being tweaked because of customs and VAT changes, do bear in mind the implications for transfer pricing. You may need to adapt your transfer pricing model. If you're moving functions, if you're moving people or risks or intellectual property cross-border, you could be liable for an exit charge outside of the UK, which could trigger tax. There are ways to manage that, but you do need to do some preparation for that. So do please not miss that. Do bear that in mind. We've talked about DAC 6 reporting, that still stays in place. Obviously, hand in hand with the exit charges point, if you're moving people, we've talked about this on previous webinars, there are the global mobility aspects to consider in terms of to what extent you will need to adjust your arrangements in terms of social security remittances and so on. So key messages, think about remitting money back to the UK if after the 1st of January 2021 you're going to have a withholding tax. Think about whether you're going to end up triggering an exit charge in terms of any of your planning that you might be doing around the customs and VAT perspective. Daniel, back to you.
Thank you very much, Yvonne. Those timely reminders that this doesn't just stop with VAT and duties, there are wider tax implications to be aware of as well. And whilst your immediate focus might be on getting those goods moving, you do need to think about the reporting further down the line. Some clients are focusing on that now where time allows, other ones are leaving it in the back pocket, but it is something that needs attending to. And thank you to Marion for illustrating what an excellent regime Ireland is for doing VAT and duties work with. It's fair to say, similar to the Netherlands, that you have a very close relationship, Marion, with the tax authority and able to discuss registrations and issues with them in much the same way as Robert Jan would in the Netherlands, I think. And Robert Jan for illustrating our close cooperation with our Netherlands counterpart firm.